Well, initially I was really stuck my head above the horizon, and I was maybe the first that people recognized. And in those days, I didn't, I started out screaming about it from the rooftops. I wanted everybody to hear, because I was still in shock about witnessing a baby being tortured and mutilated in front of me and having the doctor say there's no medical reason for doing this. So I wanted everybody to hear it. And then I realized that I was telling people something that not everybody wanted to hear. What man wants to hear, that he was strapped down and tortured and mutilated as an infant when he was too little to consent, resist, or escape? What mother wants to hear that her baby suffered needlessly? And I said this to a doctor once. What doctor wants, he's got blood on his hands, and this doctor put his hands behind his back. Talk about body language, huh? So in the early days, there were not very many people, and it was a different feeling. We were really struggling. It was an uphill battle, and it was bringing out from behind closed doors what most people had never even considered. I had no idea the depth of the, now what is it, this personal preference, cultural conditioning, religious affiliation, the fact that people make money from this, the fact that we do this to babies behind closed doors and nobody knows what's happening to their babies. It's been alarming, and it's been alarming to me that people are so resistant to something so, it's such a simple message. The baby comes to you perfect. You don't need to do anything. It doesn't take anything to stop circumcision. You don't have to, you don't have to do anything. It doesn't take money. It doesn't take energy. It doesn't take time. You just take keep the whole baby safe. That's all. It's free, and yet people still fight you to keep on mutilating kids, torturing and mutilating them. It's sort of unfathomable. I still have a hard time wondering why anybody would want to uphold that position. Why would you want to demand that you have a right to cut off part of your baby's body? I don't think I understood the extent of the damage that's done with circumcision. I didn't. I knew it was damaging. It doesn't take much. You just watch the baby, you know right away. You hear the screams, and your reptilian brain says, oh, something is terribly wrong, and your heart says, I've got to do something about it. Why aren't people doing something about it? Why don't they see this as crucial a situation as it is, as crucial an issue as it is, of how we treat babies in the beginning of life, and how that will affect them for the rest of their lives? Circumcision is a primal wound. It's where sex and violence meet for the first time. And when you inflict that kind of pain on the baby, that trauma lasts a lifetime. Even if that male never knows it, it's in every cell of the body. The brain is washed with stress hormones. You remember the commercial of this is your brain, and they crack an egg and put it into a bowl, and they say this is your brain on drugs, and they throw that egg into the frying pan. That's what happens to the baby when he's being circumcised without an analgesia. So it's a huge thing that we do to babies, and it is a primal wound. And interestingly, you know, Maimonides said when a woman has been with a man who is intact, she will not leave him. Obviously, sex is better if everything's normal. And the idea then of doing something to correct the body, helping God by correcting the body, cutting off a part of the body to make it better. We don't want people to think about that part of their body, that all that pleasure that they might have. They need to direct their lives towards a spirit and toward, you've got one life, you're here once, you know? And why is it we think that pleasure is wrong, or that this part of the body wasn't especially made more sensitive because it would ensure procreation and survival of the species? When you inflict that primal wound on that baby will circle that primal wound for the rest of his life. It's the drain of the wound that goes round and round and round. So you try to get the male not to think about his penis. By creating this violent act on this baby in the primal period, what you've done is exactly the opposite. He will think about that part of his body, even if it's from a subconscious place, and he may not recognize it. It still becomes the most important part of his body, and he will be circling the drain to that wound. Lauman and others did a study in Chicago, which showed that males who've been circumcised masturbate more often, they try more varied sex, and so forth. They prefer oral sex. Well, all of these are the things for this male trying to get the fulfillment that is rightfully his that he'll never have without the nerve endings that would have allowed him to ride the wave to orgasm and to have a full body orgasm. He doesn't have the feedback to his brain that would give that to him. So we say, oh, we want males to think about the spirit. They're not going to. Not when you inflict a wound on them. They won't think about the spirit. They're going to be attached to that wound. The laws are already in place. We have both national and international laws that defend the rights of the child. In the United States, the first law is the Constitution, and the First Amendment says you have a right to freedom of religion. If you mark that baby's body as a Jew or a Muslim, you've denied his freedom of religion and his right to self-determination. The Fourth Amendment says that every human being has a right to be secure in his person. When you take that baby, strap him 4-point restraint, and start chopping off part of the most sensitive part of his body, and there's no mistake there that the foreskin is the most sensitive part of the male body. Without an anesthetic, that baby's person is not secure. So that violates his Fourth Amendment rights. Bottom line here, however, is the right to the child trumps personal preference, cultural conditioning, religious affiliation, and even the money that some doctors or moils are making from circumcising babies. A baby's right trumps that. And it's not only constitutionally in the United States, but it's the international, you know, the Declaration of the UN Declaration for the Rights of the Child and so forth, all protect the rights of babies. So it's not that the laws aren't in place. And people are saying, oh, you can't inflict yourself into the law now. Those laws are in place. What we have to do is implement them. I think San Francisco is simply bringing this to center stage, which is a good thing because people are talking. And once people begin to talk, it's not a big step to recognizing the harm that's being done when we circumcise children.